It's sad to announce the passing of Earl Grant, one of Malcolm X's closest lieutenants. Mr. Grant passed away this year in April of 2019. Mr. Grant gave us a better understanding about Malcolm X. I'm sure you've seen him before. He's appeared in many important documentaries about Malcolm X. Here's a pictorial tribute to Mr. Grant. He was a friend, comrade, and a brother.
It never happened. It was the saddest moment of my life. First marriage. Trying to help. Thank you.
welcome to Like It Is. This edition will focus on the government surveillance of Malcolm X. We'll also have an interview with two men who spent a lot of time at Malcolm's side as he attempted to elude assassination. We'll hear that harrowing story and more right after these words. The last 15 months of Malcolm X's life were momentous, a time of tremendous personal development, and a time when opposing forces converged against him. Up until November of 1963, he had been Elijah Muhammad's first lieutenant in the Nation of Islam, or the Black Muslims, as they were also known. The Muslims were closely watched by government agencies, and Malcolm was a prime surveillance target. Attempts were made to divide this group by infiltrating their ranks and playing one human failing against the other. Now, I have here several pounds of FBI files on Malcolm X alone that support what we say and much, much more. See? Let's take a look at one of these documents. The document is entitled, "The Rift Widens Between Elijah Muhammad and His Principal Lieutenant Malcolm X Little." Part of it reads, "Little has attempted to develop sympathy and backing for his position. Feels that Elijah Muhammad is in his declining years. Would not hesitate one moment to take over the leadership of the Nation of Islam. While Muhammad may be getting older, he is far from ready to hand over the reins." The memo concludes with a statement that reads, "The attached memo or memorandum could possibly widen the rift between Muhammad and Little and possibly result in Little's expulsion from the Nation of Islam." Now, these memos were circulated by the FBI during the period when Malcolm had been silenced for 90 days by Elijah for his comments about President Kennedy's assassination in November of 1963. Interestingly, during this same period of silence, the FBI paid a visit to Malcolm's home in Queens and made some fascinating overtures. Now, it just so happens that Malcolm had installed a hidden microphone in his living room and had taped the conversation. And fortuitously, I acquired that recording. One of his aides, Earl Grant, explained how that hidden microphone came to be.
I got him in the habit of recording everything. I even had a little portable tape recorder. Used to carry around with me, and so I got all those tapes. And so I told him he should have one at his house. You never know who's going to come by, even start taping his telephone calls, you know, so he'd have a record of everything. And so we had a very high-quality machine. It was under his couch and had a little switch he could click it on. And so that was set up for that kind of eventuality. Mm-hmm. If you ever got any visitors for any kind of reason and he wanted a record of what was said, they'd never know he was taping them.
Morning, how do you do?
With the FBI. You have a couple minutes,
like
talking?
No, a couple minutes.
And your name is
Beckwith?
Beckwith.
Right.
And your name is
Fulton. Right.
From which?
New York.
New York.
There's only one.
Only one here.
It's probably what you assumed we came for, to obtain any information you want to give us about the Muslims.
I didn't assume anything.
No. That's a very general statement on my part, but as you know, we follow the activities of the Muslims as best we can. But we're always looking for new avenues of information, and who better than, than the head of the Muslims? At least up to a month ago or something like that.
We're wondering, how's your suspension status?
No one knows but Mr. Muhammad. You have to ask him.
You're still in the status as of now. You're not working now, or teaching now at all.
Well, I'm still under the suspension.
That's what I meant. Yes.
That's a temporary thing, as far as we know.
He's the only one who can give out any information on
that.
I wouldn't. I couldn't say anything beyond what he has said.
Yeah. No, I think he has said that it's a temporary suspension. Yeah. I'll be frank with you, one of the reasons we picked this particular time to contact you is because of this suspension.
The suspension was brought about by my own doing.
Yeah, exactly. But who knows what was in your mind when you did receive the suspension. In other words, bitterness could have entered into it. It would not be illogical for someone to have spent so many years doing something than be suspended.
No, it should make him stronger because it makes him realize that law applies to the law enforcer as well as those who are under the enforcement of the enforcer.
Well, you've taken nearly a perfect attitude toward the thing, which is almost unhuman, really. You've taken the attitude that Mr. Muhammad wants everyone to take if he chastises them. Which is fine. I mean, more power to you. But you see from our viewpoint that there's at least a chance, and this has happened with other members of your organization, they're suspended for some reason or other, and we talk to them, and they stand people up there, you know, and they're, of course, cooperative. Why? Because they're bitter. Now, assuming you resume your duties, we would be, as you sure know, interested in having you help us out.
Help you out to do what? We're always helping out the government. We're cleaning up all of the crime that...
Fine.
We help it out more than it helps itself. We're at least able to reform the people who have been made criminals by this society.
That's right.
By the corruption of this society. And any way to help it out other than that, I wouldn't even know how to begin.
Well, what we're interested in, basically, are the people who belong, the names, the members.
My telephone number is OL16320.
OL16320. Now, by this suggestion,
that's like telling you the sun shines in the east, from the east.
Well, no comment. And the teachings, plans, the programs.
No teaching is more public than ours, and I don't think you find anybody more blunt in stating it publicly than we do.
No, exactly.
I don't think you can go anywhere on this earth and find anybody who expresses their views on matters more candidly than we do.
I can only agree with you. I mean, no, that's right. You're right. You do. The main thing is there is a certain area of responsibility. This is getting into our angle of it. What we really want are the names of all those who belong, the names, who they are, the identification.
I don't even know them.
Do you keep no records?
It's not my job. I'm just a preacher.
Yeah, but somebody up there keeps the record.
I don't know who. I don't have any knowledge of those kind of things. With all these other responsibilities I've had, it'd be difficult for me to worry about names. Plus, you would insult my intelligence asking me for them. You'd insult your own, because it would mean that your own intelligence isn't heavy enough to weigh me and know in advance what I'm going to say when you ask that question.
Well, without getting into argument semantics there, you don't know until you ask.
That's not semantics. That again goes into your psychology.
We've had people that, not this group in particular, other groups.
Oh, yes.
Who have been just as vociferous against whatever we're investigating. Communists, make a good case out of it. Communists for 20 years, you know, they hate everything. Go interview them. You don't want to. Go anyway. So you go out, knock on the door, and they go, "Where have you been?" "Oh, I want to tell you something." You never know till you ask. And that's happened so many times. Sometimes the word isn't convinced, but sometimes money brings out the information. I have no intent to insult you here.
According to Dillon, what's his name, the Secretary of Treasury? This government's money is in such trouble until...
You can still spend it.
Still, according to your government economists, the dollar itself is in such trouble, a person would be a fool to sell his soul for one of these decreasing dollars.
Oh, yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. You'd be a fool to sell your soul if the dollar was increasing. But this has nothing to do with selling your soul. I mean, if you look at it that way, okay.
Yeah,
but
it depends on how you look at it.
Sure.
You insult my intelligence when they, and not only they insult me, period, if they think I would tell them anything.
But it would be good, and I think in many ways it might be of some benefit to your organization, you know, if in fact we can eliminate people.
There's no government agency that can ever expect any information out of me that's in any way detrimental to any religious group, or black group for that matter, in this country. No government agency.
That's fine.
Because they should use that same energy to go and find who bombed that church down there in Alabama.
Well,
and if these government agencies spend as much money and time and energy.
You know what somebody in the South is saying today? Few people would go up north and investigate the Muslims with the same energy you're trying to find this bomb here.
The Muslims don't bomb churches.
I know. They say that.
But still, the Muslims don't bomb churches. No, if we broke laws, they'd have us in jail tomorrow.
Now, that obviously is an audio recording. We didn't have picture available of that interview, so we had to supply some artistic renderings that were done by our graphics artist, Delambe Brass, and also we supplied some photographs, interwove some photographs into that, supplied to us by Robert L. Haggins. Now, it just so happens that we have the FBI report that on that interview, the agent's report of that February 4th, 1964 interview that you just heard, and that report to the head office says, the New York office does not contemplate any additional contact with Little at this time, as there appears to be no benefit to be derived therefrom. Now, despite the turndown, the FBI continued, undaunted, in their constant surveillance of Malcolm and the growing animosity towards him on the part of some members of the black Muslims. By the middle of 1964, the FBI was issuing memos like this, showing their full awareness that Malcolm's life was in serious jeopardy. Quote, in view of recent threats against subject, apparently by Nation of Islam members, the Bureau has requested that local police be advised whenever subject is in their city. Practically every move Malcolm made was being noted by the FBI. Another, subject will definitely not be in Chicago this date, since he is going to Boston and will later be in Washington, D.C. on 6/26/64, latter two offices advised. And still another memo. Omaha and Chicago should alert police in their cities as to subject's proposed trips. Also remain alert for any incidents between subject and the Nation of Islam. And when he went to Africa later that summer, the FBI received reports of Malcolm's activities over there. This memo reports, quote, Alexandria, Egypt. Malcolm addressed over 800 Muslim students representing 73 African and Asian countries, unquote. We think it important to note the vast sums of American taxpayers' monies that were spent to keep a man under surveillance who was merely fighting for justice for his people. Moreover, there seems a clear question about such intense scrutiny of a man's activities, while at the same time, there was such an apparent inability to protect him. There was, however, a small group of men who were loyal to Malcolm, and they valiantly tried to protect his life. We'll hear their story in just a moment. Earl Grant and Robert Haggins both spent a lot of time with Malcolm during those perilous last days of his life. Robert Haggins was a newspaper photographer at the time he met Malcolm, assigned to cover the Muslims, an assignment he really didn't want.
I had covered a lot of religious organizations and subcultures and so-called cults and religion in Harlem. The holy rollers, churches over Christ, under Christ, in Christ, on top of Christ, and then the black Jews, and then we had a group called the Dombala Whalens, the Voodooists, and crucifying chickens and animals and all kinds of gods that only appear when you've been under the influence or having consumed large amounts of alcohol. So I was fed up, and I tried to give the assignment to some of the other photographers.
You thought this was just another cult?
Another cult. A man, a grown man, calling himself X, didn't know his own last name. So that turned me off. I figured, it's this guy calling himself Malcolm X, you know, X meaning mystery. So I tried to sell the assignment. Another photographer would take the assignment and I would work in his place. I couldn't get anybody to take it, so I had to go out there.
What was it about him that struck you?
Well, for one thing, the discipline, the fact that everyone was organized, and the respect for each other, and the way Malcolm addressed me, sir, yes sir, no sir, the immaculate cleanliness, the restaurant, and the whole demeanor of Malcolm as an individual. And then when Malcolm began to explain to me about his name, about why he called himself X, and the fact that he refused to carry the slave master's name, and he went into a lecture on the word Negro, explaining to me that most English words derive its meaning from Latin or Greek. And in Greek, the G in Negro became C, which meant that N-E-C-R-O means dead. Necropolis, necra, necrophilia, necrosis, all of these terms relate to something dead, something without a life. And then Malcolm looked at me and said, well, you know, don't they call you a spook? You know, you Negroes are spooks, a walking dead man. So, you know, that day on the way home, I started thinking about this man and some of the things he talked about. And I wanted to know more about Malcolm. I wanted to know more about the movement. And that developed the fascination.
Mm-hmm. Now, what was the extent of your relationship? Was it just that you were his photographer, or was it more involved than that?
In the beginning, it was a photographic thing from the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
And then I quit my job to work for Malcolm as his personal photographer. And the reason why, at that time, Malcolm had an uncanny sense of the value of the media and the value of pictures. He knew that the media was creating him in terms of being a monster. All of those early photographs of Malcolm depicted him as some kind of monster, fists clenched and blazing eyes and teeth clenched, all this sort of thing. So he wanted me to make photographs of him as a human being. And it was during this process that we became friends, and my relationship changed. I no longer was an impartial journalist as a photographer. I began to take pictures and also to think in terms of what kind of contribution I could make to him. Yes, how I could help him in his movement. Because I would go out sometimes and meet with other members of various newspapers to find out how they felt about Malcolm, how they felt about Malcolm's movement. And I would sit down with him at a later date and explain to him how he was being depicted, how the public was seeing him. And in that way, I was able to help Malcolm. I helped Malcolm to understand how his image was coming over.
Why were you so concerned and obsessed with helping him?
Well, I feel, as I do now, that Malcolm was the only leader we had, as far as I'm concerned. I listened to all of the other leaders at that time, and they all were involved with some segment of being an integrationist. They all wanted to lead our people into a movement where they would become invisible. But Malcolm wasn't doing that. Malcolm was the only leader out there that taught black people to be proud of being black and not try to be something that you can never be. And to go a step further, Malcolm thought that integration was ridiculous because...
Yes.
Because a no minority group can bring about integration with the majority group.
And so you quit a job...
Yes.
...to go work for him.
That's right.
Now, as things got more and more dangerous, what thoughts ran through your mind? Did you ever feel as though you should jump ship because you knew that things were getting hot?
Yes, there was times when I thought about that. And I thought about the danger, and I realized that it was possible that I could get killed. And I talked about that with my family.
Mm-hmm.
And I talked about the danger of sudden death, walking with Malcolm, taking pictures of Malcolm, because I knew that if a shotgun blast was coming at Malcolm and I was in the vicinity, I would probably get killed also. But I had faced many dangerous assignments prior to Malcolm X. And I was used to that. I took my chances.
You felt for some reason that it was worth it?
Yes, I do.
In what way?
Well, the role that Malcolm played in our society is something that we will learn to appreciate as time goes on, because sooner or later, black people will have to realize that the things that Malcolm was saying is true. They were true then, and they're true now.
You remember the Nation of Islam?
Yeah, yeah.
But what happened? Did you ultimately leave?
Yeah, I left.
Why?
Because there was nothing for me to do. They really didn't have any program for black people that had a lot of skills. The only thing they had for you to do is sell newspapers, and anybody can go out and sell newspapers. Now, you don't go to school and learn all these things and end up peddling newspapers.
What kind of skills did you have to offer?
Well, photography, electronics, and I'm a very good researcher.
Mm-hmm.
And I had some strange training in the service, I used to tell Malcolm about.
So even though you liked Malcolm, you couldn't cut the organization, so you left.
Yeah.
And then after the split, what happened?
Well, after the split, I read about it in the newspaper. And as soon as I read it, I knew something crazy was going on. Because nobody stops betting on a winning team unless you've gone crazy. So when they put him out, I called him up the next day. And he was glad to hear from me. So he said he'd like to see me. He had a lot to talk about. So I gave him my address, and he drove over to the house. And we spent the whole day talking about a lot of things that had gone on. And how he found out about a lot of things. What he planned on doing, he was hoping he could just do the 90 days and then go back, even if he couldn't go back as a minister. He just wanted to be a member of it. But after the 90 days was up, we realized that was never going to take place, so we had to get going. We had a world-renowned figure, and no organization, no mailbox, no nothing. So we were playing catch-up most of the time. And We started holding meetings in various people's houses, and then we started meeting in the Audubon, and then there were people who always claimed they wanted to be a part of it, but they couldn't deal with the discipline of the religion, so that's what the OAAU was set up for, give them something to do. And some people came in, a lot of good people came in, and they did some very good work.
And then when did the heat really become intense?
After he gave the speech down at the Militant Labor Forum. See, when you go around calling white people the devil, they don't mind that. They put you on television, let you come around the college campuses and pay you honorariums. But when he spoke down there, he explains what it meant to be head of the Senate Armed Services Committee, what it means to be head of the Senate Judiciary Committee, all those kind of, how the government really functions. Not the spookism, but how it really works. And when we came out of the building that night, we were standing there, me, him, and Brother John, waiting for him to bring his car around. And I told him, I said, man, we're in trouble now. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, you didn't stop talking nonsense and start explaining how it operates. You're not supposed to do that. Because most Americans don't know how this country operates. White or black, they don't have any idea how this country operates.
What did he say?
Well, he explained how government agencies work, how they work in other countries.
No, I mean, what did he say about your remark?
Oh, he said, well, something to the effect that that's the kind of organization we're trying to develop where people really understand, that they have to understand things. And so his teachings were becoming less religious and more political and analytical. There was a definite shift away from the religious base.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then that's when you became aware, you all became aware that some people wanted to take his life.
Right, right.
And then I guess your role with him started to change from a researcher and organizer to a bodyguard, huh?
Just about, yeah, yeah. Very close to it.
How would you parcel that out in your work day? I mean, you had to work to feed yourself.
Yeah, well, I had a night job. Mm-hmm. And so other brothers would be with him in the evenings, and I'd be with him and some other people during the daytime.
And how do they phrase it? You carried some heat with you.
Well, Malcolm said if you thought it was going to rain, you should have your raincoat with you.
And so everywhere he went, you were with him? And
not everywhere, but most of the places, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you would sort of arrange to meet at places every morning?
Right, right.
And then you'd be with him for throughout the day?
Yeah, we'd try to stay with him everywhere.
Were you involved in a lot of those confrontations that we read about?
Yeah, there's one at Adam Clayton Powell's church. That's when he spoke to the Domestic Peace Corps, I think it was. And when we were there, there was some commotion outside. We looked out and there were a lot of the people there from Elijah Muhammad's group. And so the brothers were getting kind of sort of, well, I guess getting warm under the collar. So I talked to them, quiet them down. I said, as long as they just stand out there and look ignorant, let them stand out there and look ignorant. And I told Malcolm they was out there, and he said, well, just keep your eye on them. And when we left, we went up to 135th Street, and we crossed the street, and there used to be a shoe shine stand there, and Bumpy Johnson was sitting up in there getting his shoe shine. And we come across, he looked out, he jumped down, right out, and grabbed Malcolm's hand. He said, hey, brother, he said, we've been reading about you here, you got some problems. He said, yeah, I kind of have some. He said, so Bumpy told him, he said, well, you know how to handle that, man. All you got to do is make a phone call, and that'll be taken care of. That's what he told him. Me and Malcolm were standing there. I think Benjamin may have been there, I'm not sure. So they talked for a while about the old times. And we walked down 135th toward Lenox Avenue. I told Malcolm, I says, you know what he meant, don't you? He said, yeah, I know what he meant. He said, I don't want black folks killing black people. That was his attitude. And a lot of those people down there need to be told that the only reason some of them are still walking around is because Malcolm allowed them to keep walking around. Because there was another group of his old buddies from his running days out in the streets that came up to see him, came up to the Teresa Hotel, as a matter of fact. And I saw some of them about 2 weeks ago. I was with them. And I keep in touch with them. And they came up and offered their services just for old time's sake. So they'd take care of it, you know. And Malcolm, he would never let that go on. And he always told us we could defend ourselves but never attack them, because he didn't want us to. Because he felt responsible for all those brothers being down there. It was listening to him that brought them in there. So he didn't, even though they were ignorant. And you can see where it's at. This guy that's in prison now, 14, 15 years later, he's beginning to understand that he was manipulated. Well, even back in those days, we knew somebody was running a game on them.
What role did the police play in this, when all these people were after him? all these attempts were made on his life. Where were the police?
Well, they're in the temple in Los Angeles. I wasn't there, but he told me about it. That's when they had that high-speed chase. And there was no police around that I ever heard of. The only time I ever saw the police do anything for Malcolm was in Philadelphia, when we were down there. And we were in the hotel after the meeting. And I think the police were downstairs. These are all black policemen. I didn't see any white cops. The police were downstairs at the door. They were in Malcolm's hotel room. They were outside. They told me they were on both sides. They had the rooms on both sides and the room upstairs over.
So in Philadelphia, you saw good police support, although you're not sure whether it came from the police department or whether these police officers, who you say were black, just took it upon themselves because they liked the man.
Yeah.
But anyhow, he was safe when he went to Philly.
Man, they had shotguns everywhere.
Really?
They were not playing.
But wherever else he went, there wasn't that kind of police concern or even anything near to it.
Nothing. No way.
But now, it was clear. Everybody knew that he was being hunted.
Right.
Including the police.
Yeah, I guess they can read.
And yet the police were not running interference?
No. No way.
So what conclusions do you draw, and what conclusions did he draw at the time?
That whoever it was, well, like the thing in France, he couldn't land there. He knew that there's no way in the world the Muslims could have arranged that. The French government didn't take orders from Muhammad, and from nobody else for that matter. So he knew it had to be somebody way up higher than the average run-of-the-mill person, even local police department. They couldn't have pulled off anything like that. And they're, well, I guess they're the same forces that got rid of John Fitzgerald Kennedy. He had Secret Service all around him, but that didn't protect him. You see? Who can get better protection than the president?
One would have thought that.
Yeah, one would have thought that. So if they could get him, we wasn't looking for any help from anybody. This is a tough world. It's a risky world. You have to take chances. Things belong to people who grab at them. You can't just sit back and wait for things to happen for you. The whole existence of black people in this country has been a struggle from day one. And what little progress we have made has been because somebody made it happen. It isn't because of the way we part our hair. That's not the reason we've done it. Somebody had to make it happen. And that's what Malcolm was trying to do. He's trying to make it happen. And I even meet people now from Elijah's group. I see them all the time. They're in Harlem. Who just now, well, I guess in the last few years, beginning to see what was really going on then, the trick they were caught up in.
What kind of an attitude did Malcolm himself have about all of these things that were going against him, even though all the man was trying to do was do right? What was his attitude like?
Oh, we had started, so we had to continue. We couldn't turn back. We had to go as far as we could with it. And then the next generation could take off from there.
He knew that that was all she wrote.
Oh, yeah. None of us were planning on dying of old age. I mean, we hadn't even thought about that. One of the reasons why insurance wasn't important to us and all that kind of stuff. You're living so fast, man, you don't have time to think about a lot of things. It's a fast life when people are hunting you all the time. And you never know who's going to be after you next. So,
what was his attitude toward police, the Bureau, at that time?
Oh, I don't think we really ever discussed it. Well, we didn't.
It was just taken for granted, though, that they were not a source of protection.
No. That kind of situation, you look out for yourself the best you can.
Is that why he went through such great lengths with both of you, I guess, to put down a record? You, Earl, you recorded a lot of his speeches.
Yeah.
And Bob, you were taking pictures.
Yeah.
Because he wanted to leave as good a record as possible of what he was about.
That's right.
in the little time that he had, huh?
Yeah, we knew that time was running out on us, and especially after the bombing of his house, but even before the bombing of his house, we'd be standing out there on 125th Street in front of Chock Full of Nuts, and Joseph, the captain from down there, used to come by in that old station wagon they had. He had Norman Butler sitting in the right seat right by him, and he'd point us out to him, to Butler. And he'd come up there one day, and he's pointing us out. So I walked right over to him. I said, get a good look. He said, make sure you get a good look, and don't make no mistakes. And he starts smiling, and he drove off. And then another time, they came around in a car. We were coming out of the hotel with Malcolm. They pulled right up in front of the Teresa Hotel, and I walked right up to him, and he said something like, I said, I'm like a brother. I just looked at him. I said, you make sure you get a good look at me. You just have to let people like that know that you scramble their eggs if you have to.
What happened that day? Your role normally at the Audubon was to record his speeches.
Yeah.
And so you were setting up that day?
I'd already set it up.
And what
we were set up before he got there.
Mm-hmm. And when he got there, what did he do?
Well, we stopped in the back and talked for a few minutes. And he looked around.
How'd he look?
Haggard, worn, like he'd aged 10 years in the last week. And so we went on into the back of the, behind the stage of the Audubon. He's sitting back there at a table. And there are four or five people back there with him. And we were talking about getting it started. I kept telling him he didn't even have to make a speech. I'd get him out of there. But he wanted to make it anyway. And so Benjamin said he would open up. And he sent me out to to call Ralph Cooper. I was going to call Ralph Cooper. He was supposed to have been there, supposed to be heading up some kind of fundraiser for Malcolm after his house was burned. And I told him, well, let somebody else go out and make a phone call. Man, I don't go around making phone calls. The women do that. But he insisted that I do it. And he was just adamant about it. I had to go make the phone call. And when I went out, I was in the phone booth when I heard the first shot, and then there were some more shots, and then here come all these people just pouring out the door. And this guy, later identified as Hare, whatever his name is, he was running out, still had the gun in his hand, and a bunch of people were kicking him and knocking him until they finally knocked him down, and they were kicking him all in the face and chest and everything. And as I remember him, he looked like a zombie. His eyes were bulging, like he was either high on something or he'd been hypnotized. I don't know what was wrong with him, but he just looked like a zombie, and he never let out a sound. And they were about to kick his chest in, and there was no outcry of pain or anything. He looked like a robot.
What did you do?
Well, after this mob kind of got out of the doorway, they had those big double doorways, I got into the room, into the main auditorium, and people were everywhere. Some were laying on the ground, on the floor. A couple of them were shot, and I went past them, got up to the stage, and Malcolm was laying on his back, and Brother Lukeman was with him, and some other people. And they were opening up his chest, and I saw all those holes.
I knew it was over.
Was he still breathing?
No, I don't think so. I mean, it was so hectic, I don't think so. That was Brother Lukeman was there with him, and then. So I just got my camera out to get as many pictures as I could of everything, because you always have a record of these kind of things. And then when, after I guess it sounded, to me it was like 20 minutes or half an hour before the hospital people got in there from across the hospital. The Presbyterian was right across the street, and they wheeled him over there. And then they surrounded the place like it was Fort Knox. I don't know what the hell they think we were going to do. And they wouldn't let any of us in. We had to sneak Betty around the back of the police to get her in. And I came back down. There was a sister. I'll never forget it. She was standing up in the middle of Broadway crying, standing right out. Muriel. She was one of the secretaries. And so I got with the brothers and I told them that it was all over and that everybody should go home, just remain quiet. They want to run down and blow everybody at the Muslim, at the Muhammad's temple. I said, man, don't be ridiculous. They ain't gonna do this. Mm-hmm. they could never organize anything like that. So they all agreed with that, and they went home. And the next day, we went about, from that day on, to the funeral, organizing the funeral, making sure it would be held, and getting the brothers who were going to be the pallbearers and all that. And there were bomb threats at the church, Reverend Childs' church, and we let it out that we didn't care what they said. We was going to hold Malcolm's funeral. Just didn't give a damn. We're going to hold it anyway. See, when you understand that everybody dies, that nobody lives forever, then people can't threaten you. You can only be threatened if you're dumb enough to think you can live forever. Then people can threaten you. When you know that everybody out there in the cemetery is dead, there ain't no live people out there, mm-hmm. that they all dead, then people can't threaten you. You can look any man in the eye and tell them to go to hell. And that was our attitude. And we were going to hold this funeral. We didn't care what anybody thought, man. We're going to hold it anyway. So we held the funeral and got him out to the cemetery, buried him, and that was it. But we kept the organization going as long as we could.
Did you take part in that burial?
Certainly, I was right there.
Did you put scoops of earth on his...
No, I didn't get that close. I was watching everything as usual. And
what were nights like for you in those days immediately after the assassination?
Oh, man, I don't think I got a 4-hour sleep straight at no time during that week from the time he was, as a matter of fact, from the time his house was bombed until we buried him. I never got a full night's sleep till after that was all over. And then we had to keep the organization going as best as we could.
Wait a minute, things were hot now.
Certainly.
So what happened? Did you stay in town?
No. I had some place to go and stay. You always have some place to go. If you should plan ahead in anything, you do have a contingency plan.
So you did leave town?
No, I didn't leave town. I was right here in New York City. Mm-hmm. I just had some place to be.
But didn't you ultimately go?
Yeah, but before that, the night, say when he was shot that Sunday night, you would never guess where I stayed. I stayed on Sutton Place. That's where I was, in an expensive bed. The chair in there cost $400. That's where I was. And then after that, somebody met me at the Apollo Theater the night they had the fundraiser there. All of us and Sammy Davis came up that night, Sammy Davis Jr., and told me that they had gotten word that I should take a vacation. And 3 days later, I was in Ghana.
Both of you agreed. I've been after both of you men for a long time to get you in front of a camera to talk about this ugly chapter. What made you finally decide to talk?
Well, I don't like to remember it, because it were good times, but the way he died was a very painful part of my life. I don't like to remember it. Maybe it will inspire some of these young people to learn about Malcolm, find out what he was trying to do, and to continue to struggle, because that's, in my view, that's the best thing they can do to help themselves in this mess over here, to learn the strict discipline he had, the toughness of mind, not to be taken off by all of the negative attractiveness of this society, the drugs, this noise that people call disco, and all of the other deceptions that you find in this country. These kids have really got to, the ones that are still capable of doing it, really begin to turn themselves around and look inward for inner strength, because there's nothing outside. Your strength comes from inside, and it comes from understanding who you are and what you're about.
Somebody might say, why would you focus so strong on this man? You know, was he the only hope, really?
Well,
is it possible that all of this hope could reside within one soul?
My knowledge of the history of human beings is from time to time, rare people are born, like Genghis Khan, Gandhi, there are people that stand out in history, like Akhenaten in ancient Egypt, and they seem to personify all of the hopes and aspirations of a whole nation of people. You see it, it appears in one human being. And when that person appears all around them, they have to support him because he can't do it alone. Like all of these people had to support Gandhi, or India would still be a colony. And they killed him too.
And that's where you place Malcolm.
Oh man, he was a historic figure. He was a holy man. That's one of the reasons he's not alive today. If he hadn't have been so pure and kept us and a lot of other people that way, we probably could have kept him long. We could have kept him alive longer, maybe not forever. We could have done it. But we were never allowed to touch anybody, unless in defense. Other than that. And these other people I told you about that offered to assist him, he would not permit it. He was really a holy man. He was too clean to be kept alive in this country. Couldn't do it.
How do you feel, Bob?
I think Earl has echoed my sentiments. I think that the reason why I've decided to come here now is because it's time. You see, young black people out there are looking for leadership. They're looking for motivation, some kind of inspiration. And it's up to us to provide that for them, to let them know that the only solution to the black problem is not to force yourself on somebody else, to stop begging and knocking at the door and chasing white people all over the globe. It's time to stop and reassess your own values as a human being and to to set proper goals, to learn organization, to learn research techniques, to look at organizations, to organize to solve your own problems.
Is there some way in which, in understanding his life and death, it'll be of help to us today?
What they have to understand, well, Americans are people in this country in general, are known for not knowing very much about the past. They have to understand, especially this young generation, that a lot of these people with their MBAs and their sports cars and their corporate vice presidencies, they have to know that they're not there just because of the way they wear their clothes or the way they part their hair. That somebody paved the way for them to get there, and that they owe some debts, and that they have a responsibility to history to do something else other than just check cashers every week. They have a role to play. They have a people to serve. And until they, and unless they do that, as Jorge Santayana said, people who don't understand the lessons of history are doomed to repeat them. And there were a group of people in Europe a few years ago who thought they were just other Germans. They thought they were super Germans. Unfortunately for them, that wasn't so. And you've got a lot of people, a lot of our younger people coming out of these schools and going into these corporations, they think they're just another corporate figure. Well, that's not so. No way. That's not so. They're only there because somebody paved the way, and like those kids down in the south, that church that was blown up. It was like preachers down there were trying to get people to register to vote that were killed. Dr. King being killed, Medgar Evers. All this younger generation need to have it burned into their brain how they got where they are, and that the road was not, it was not easy, and that they are not in heaven. That's one of their main problems. They think they're in heaven now, but they're not. They're still here. They got a long ways to go, and if you, there's this book entitled The Choice. There's an article in there where he talks about a study in 1970 by the U.S. Navy. What would be the attitude of white people in this country if black folks were beginning to be systematically suppressed like the Jews in Germany? And the study pointed out that most white people wouldn't care. I mean, that's a horrifying thought for me. I mean, really, really disturbing that anybody would even think to conduct a study like that in this country is scary. But But that was the conclusion of it. If they started rounding up black folks and started making them disappear from the city, most people wouldn't care. They just wouldn't care. That's what the study said, that they wouldn't care.
Do you anticipate running into anybody close to this caliber man in the rest of your life on this planet?
No. It only happens once in a while. Like we had a Toussaint down there in Haiti. We had some of the Santahinis over there in Ghana. We had a John Fitzgerald Kennedy. You look at Washington today and there's no replacement for him. These people only happen every now and then. And that's interesting. You had a young white man and a young black man who tried to make the kind of changes that this country needs, and they were both eliminated. Then you had the man of peace was eliminated. So that tells you that the people who run this show don't plan on making any changes anyway.
You think there's a connection between those assassinations and the people who run this show, as you say?
Absolutely.
Do you regret your years with Malcolm?
Not a single day. Not one second. None of the brothers do. It's the best thing ever happened to us.
What was it about him that made you willing to lay down your life for him?
Well, for one thing, he was honest. He never lied. If he ever said anything to you, you could bet on it. And he was sincere in what he was trying to do. And I guess I really never thought about things like that. We didn't take time out to think about things like that. Mm-hmm. We had something to do, so we did it. With just a few of us, Luke, mother, myself, Brother John, Brother Ivory.
What is it that hurts you so when you talk about those days, Earl?
It was a chance to really be somebody. This country doesn't allow black males to mature. It allows them to grow up physically, but not to mature mentally, intellectually, or spiritually. And Malcolm gave black men that chance in this country.
This week, Entertainment Tonight sparkles with Helen Reddy, Dorothy Lyman of All My Children, Jane Kennedy, and Suzanne Plachette. They're all on this week, and it starts with Helen Reddy tomorrow night at 7:30.